nearest to real life. Please go ahead.
Thank you so much. Thank you. So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, our friends from various universities, education institutions across the nation. Myself, Neeraj Arora, I am Senior Director at SOCHEM and look after the education vertical. I would like to welcome you all on behalf of SOCHEM and IES University for this wonderful webinar on NEP 2020 opportunities and challenges for Madhya Pradesh towards becoming an educational hub. So friends, this topic is very important, and for the discussion, we have a galaxy of speakers with us, starting with Shri Kumar Shekhar Vijendra Ji, who is co-chairman for SOCHEM National Council on Education and co-founder and chancellor Shobhit University. Welcome, Kumar Shekhar Ji. We have with us engineer B.S. Yadav Ji, vice chair MPN Chhattisgarh for SOCHEM Education Council and chancellor IES University. Welcome, engineer B.S. Yadav Ji. We have engineer Bharat Sharan Ji with us, chairman Madhya Pradesh Private University Regulatory Commission, Bhopal, MP. Welcome, Dr. Bharat Sharan Ji. We have Professor Dheeraj Kumar Ji with us, Director, National Institute of Design, Madhya Pradesh. Welcome, Dheeraj sir. We have Professor Kamlesh Mishra Ji with us, who is Vice Chancellor, Rishud University. Welcome, Professor Kamlesh Mishra Ji. And we have with us Professor Manisha Kavthekar Ji, who is the Dean, Corporate Affairs, IES University, and is the session moderator for the day. So Professor Manisha Kavthekar is currently working as Dean, Corporate Affairs in IES University, Bhopal. She has worked with the Dabha Research Foundation as Research Associate on various research projects for industry. She has 25 years of experience in education at prestigious schools at Bhopal, and is the founder member of all IES public school branches at Bhopal and Sihor, which have been taken from inception to senior secondary level and are among the most reputed awarded school in the respective cities. Presently, she is Dean Corporate Affairs at IES, mentoring students for placement through personality development, grooming, and ensuring their welfare. So, madam, over to you.
Thank you, sir, for the kind introduction. And very good afternoon and warm welcome to all the eminent speakers of today's national webinar on NEP 2020, Opportunities and Challenges for Madhya Pradesh Towards Becoming an Educational Hub. I welcome Shri Kumar Shekhar Vijendra Ji, co-chairman SOCHEM National Council on Education and co-founder and chancellor Shobhit University, Engineer B.S. Yadav sir, Vice Chair, MPCG, SOCHEM Educational Council, and Honorable Chancellor, IES University. Dr. Bharat Sharan Singh, Chairman, Madhya Pradesh Private University Regulatory Commission, Bhopal. Professor Dheeraj Kumar, Director, National Institute of Design, MP. Professor Kamlesh Mishra sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Rishod University. Mr. Neeraj Arora, Senior Director and Head, SOCHEM National Council on Education. Shri Deepak Chabra, Shri Harish Pushpakar from SOCHEM, all the eminent educationists, faculties, and participants of this webinar. The NEP 2020 has proposed necessary changes to our existing educational system, right from early childhood to higher education, and has generated positive vibes in our educational sector. Several aspects of education we'll see a transformation, example, curriculum, pedagogy, teachers training, etc. And it'll help in skill development in students, preferably in curtailing dropout rates, in better employability, and so on. So India has over 1,000 higher educational institutes today, including over 150 of national importance. Over the years, it has also become a hub of scientific research. Our higher educational institutions have shown consistent growth in both quality and quantity of research in this past decade. India currently ranks third in global terms in the research output. Three aspects of focus for educational institutions are, of course, the knowledge generation, research and development, and innovation. So when we talk of MP, our higher educational institutions are performing well in the first two aspects and will be progressing on the innovation front too. So today, it is our privilege to seek advice from our experts on how to implement NEP to expand the horizons of higher education in MP by understanding the existing challenges and, of course, perceiving ways of overcoming them. So it's my pleasure now to welcome our first eminent speaker. So we have with us Kuvar Shekhar Vijayendra Ji, co-chairman, ASSOCHAM National Council on Education, co-founder and honorable chancellor, Shobhit University. Sir Kuvar Shekhar Vijayendra is the honorable chancellor of Shobhit University, Meerut, and Shobhit University, Gangoh, and is the founder executive trustee of NICE Society Trust, a not-for-profit organization. To meaningfully contribute towards social upliftment, economic growth, employment generation, empowerment, and overall development of youth on a sustainable basis, he volunteered to work full-time with NICE Society Trust. For the last 28 years, he has been instrumental in the development of a number of educational, social, and health organizations, including two universities in our country. Presently, he plans, advises, and initiates development of academic skill and skill training institutions worldwide, especially in the countries with substantial Indian diaspora. So, sir, we are waiting to hear from you, and I welcome you to take up the stage.
Thank you very much, Professor Manisha. It is indeed a pleasure for me to join today on this very important webinar organized by ASSOCHAM National Council on Education. On behalf of ASSOCHAM National Council on Education, I congratulate IES University for taking the initiative with us, for joining hands with us. And I'm thankful to all the eminent speakers, audience, and everybody who is involved in it, and special thanks to my team from ASSOCHAM, Mr. Neeraj, Deepak, and Harsh for doing a wonderful job indeed. The topic of the day is very important. Madhya Pradesh is the central state of the country. So, and the topic is also a very important, a central focus topic in educational sector today. As Professor Manisha was mentioning that we have 1,000+ institutions of higher education, I would like to correct that we have 1,000+ universities in the country with around 40,000 higher education institutions. So it is a large number, maybe one of the largest number in the world. Where demographically we are very rich, the same way educationally we had been rich in past and in present also. National Education Policy 2020 has given us an opportunity to revisit our education system, to see what was good in past, to see what is happening good globally, and to integrate it and make a model which is not only having ancient values, but is having other things also. The modern technologies also, innovation also, research also, everything is there. If I look at the topic of the day, NEP 2020, opportunities and challenges for Madhya Pradesh towards becoming an educational hub. When this word educational hub comes to me, so educational hub does not mean to have a large number of institutions only. Educational hub means a place where excellence is there, a place where expansion is possible, a place where equal access of the opportunities is there, equal access of education is there, and a place where employable youth is generated. So once we are in position to create that thing, then it becomes an educational hub, even without having a very large number of educational institutions. I'm happy that Dr. Bharat Charan Singh Ji was just mentioning that Madhya Pradesh has declared and started initiative for the implementation of NEP 2020 recently. And they have uploaded a lot of modules and other things that how it will be implemented. I generally have a reservation, which before starting I was sharing. Generally what happens that many times when we are trying to implement a new education policy, we feel that everybody should act the way we say. As we have an opportunity to have the chairman of Madhya Pradesh Private University Regulatory Commission with us. So that has to be seen, because every university, be it a deemed university, central university, state university, private university, or institution of national importance, they have their own mandate. They have a vision, and their vision and mandate may be different from other universities. So sometimes I have a reservation, and I'm afraid, honestly, that sometimes I feel that maybe if we will put everybody in a single box, it may challenge the uniqueness of everybody. What Professor Manisha was telling about innovation, innovation starts when we are given an opportunity to think uniquely, differently. When we have an opportunity to have flexibility to do things in our own way. So that is one of the very important conditions if we want to become an educational hub, if we want to develop some centers of excellence anywhere in the world. Universities are nowadays, like our country, complete economy is knowledge-centric economy, and universities are playing three important roles, actually. Earlier, it was only to teach. Now, universities are place and platform for knowledge transfer. Universities are a platform for skill development. And universities are now directly involved in economic growth of the society. So when I use this word, it means universities have a wealth of research knowledge, talent, and network connections. And it means the role of the government and the private sector both becomes very important to come together. ASSOCHAM is one such platform. And this, our National Council on Education is working very deeply, very sincerely in that direction, where we want to give an opportunity to the government bodies, to private bodies, to everybody to come together, discuss, deliberate, and debate about the possibilities, how we all can work together. When I look at the education, I think that it is our collective responsibility, national collective responsibility, which include the government also, to ensure that all young people have equal access to high quality, world-class education. It means that not only having institutions will serve the purpose, especially in Madhya Pradesh, where tribal areas are there, tribal population is there, it means challenges are more. We have to create a social infrastructure also. We have to see that right opportunities available for the education professionals also, not only to the profession only, but for the professionals also. So government has to work for teachers' preparation, teachers' training, a lot of other things are there which need to be done. And for research especially, I would like to mention over here what we are advocating from ASSOCHAM and otherwise also, that research cannot be done by a university without handholding by the government. It means I will request through Dr. Sharan Singh that if we wish, really wish, that our private universities also should do wonderful research, if we wish that Madhya Pradesh should become educational hub, a real educational hub of innovation, research, wonderful academics, then please do hold their hand also. When we are having these parameters, you have to work this way, the same way they have to be given that flexibility also. In the national budget speech, the Honorable Finance Minister, she was speaking about a knowledge grid, knowledge hub. And what she was talking about, that she was giving an example of Hyderabad that time. She said that they are taking an initiative where all the educational institutions of Hyderabad, they will come together and they will share the resources. I think a knowledge grid is required in every state, in every city, everywhere in this country. And that initiative can be taken through this commission and through the government also, where any university who is having some good thing, a center of excellence, a lab of excellence, a teacher of excellence even, they must be in position to share those resources. Like a knowledge grid, like power grids we have, the same way knowledge grid has to be created. And those knowledge grids can do wonders. Again, I will mention SOCHM, RO Council. We are doing that part also. We are trying to bridge everybody together. We are trying to give them an opportunity to do that. The same way is one SEIZ, an initiative what at Shobhit University we have started. I would like to share it for Madhya Pradesh also there. Like we have SEZ. And SEZ is generally established where we need to develop the economic thing. We want to promote more economic models. The same way SEIZ at Shobhit University we started. This is a skill entrepreneurship innovation zone. And what we are doing here, that we are providing our resources to the availability to the schools nearby, to the students, to anybody who is having an idea. We are telling, okay, when we are not using our infrastructure, maybe in the evening, on Sundays, or otherwise, why don't you come and use them? So a hub of talent has started coming. Ideas are coming to the university. Patents have started coming out of that. Research has started coming out. So these such initiatives, I think we have to take along with wonderful initiatives what Madhya Pradesh government is taking under the leadership of Honorable Chief Minister. And I'm sure that not many discussion and ideas will come in this deliberation. And we will be for sure make the state of Mahakal the state of creation, also a wonderful state, a hub of education. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Guba Shekhar Vijayendraji. As you suggested, all the 44,000 institutes, if they create a knowledge grid and there is hand holding by the government and sharing of infra through the SEZs, then certainly Madhya Pradesh will become a very eminent state through the NEP. Thank you so much, sir. Next, I wish to invite Engineer B.S. Yadav, sir, Honorable Vice Chair, SOCHM Education Council, MP Chhattisgarh, and Honorable Chancellor, IS University. Sir is an engineer by education and founder of the Infotech Education Society, which runs IS University, Bhopal. He holds several esteemed leadership positions, including Chairman, IS Public School, Bhopal and Sihor, Managing Director, IS Consultancy Services Private Limited, among others. He completed his BE in 1994 from RGPB Bhopal, and he also has a postgraduate degree in HRM from IIM Lucknow. With a vision and commitment towards quality education and for preparing the best human resources as per the acceptable global standards, he conceptualized and founded the Infotech Education Society 2 decades ago, which has been serving society with education. Under the able guidance of our founder chancellor, the campus has been awarded as the first green campus and has bagged several awards along with the NET Education Excellence Award, the Best Training and Placement Institute, and 4-star rating by AICT in the Innovation Council, and so on. So he's a committed philanthropist, and in this pandemic has facilitated the IS Hospital and Research Center for providing health facility with free camps to the local community, supported with a COVID vaccination camp of over 6,500 locals. So over to you, sir.
Thank you, Manisha. Very good afternoon and warm welcome to Honorable Co-Chairman SOCHM, National Council for Education, Kumar Shekhar sir, Dr. Bharat Saran Singh ji, Chairman MP Private University Regulatory Commission, Professor Dheeraj Kumar ji, Director NID MP, Professor Kamlesh Misra ji, BC Institute University, Sonipat, Neeraj Arora ji, Senior Director and Head, National Council on Education, SOCHM, Deepak Chhabra ji, Harish ji, all eminent educationists, faculties and participants to this national webinar on NEP 2020, opportunity and challenges for Madhya Pradesh to become education hub. As the Shekhar sir already told about a very holistic view about on national level about the education sector and its importance in nation development. So I just like to draw all the panelists and this attention and the, all the audience. MP is the second largest Indian state in terms of area and fifth largest state in terms of the population. In terms of economy, size of the economy, MP is the 10th largest state in the India. It is rich in mineral resources with more than 30% forest coverage. Tourism industry of the state has seen considerable growth due to three World Heritage sites, forest cover, natural beauty, rich art and culture, and population fabric and prints. According to recent survey, MP has a literacy rate around 70%. The state is home to 67 universities, including 39 private universities, 23 state universities, 2 central and 2 deemed universities. Many institutions of national importance, just like AIIMS Bhopal, ICER Bhopal, IIFM Bhopal, National Judicial Academy, IIT Indore, IIM Indore, IITDM Jabalpur, IITM Gwalior, and Manit Bhopal. The Indira Gandhi National Tribal University Amarkating is also located in Madhya Pradesh, which is very unique for promoting education among tribals and their culture. In terms of the strength of Madhya Pradesh to become education hub, MP is located in central India, has a good geographically advantage with its major cities are well connected by rail, road and air. Indore and Bhopal have excellent air connectivity with more than 50 flights per day. With 67 higher education institutions and many more hub for higher and technical education, students from over more than 10 states are studying in the state of Madhya Pradesh, just like Bihar, Jharkhand, UP, Gujarat, Chhattisgarh, many northern states, even from NCR region also. Financial advantage. In Madhya Pradesh, cost of living is low compared to the metro city, NCR and other metro cities of the country. Excellent law and order compared to many parts of the country. In terms of living, Bhopal and Indore is the number one city in the country in terms of cleanliness, and Bhopal is number one state capital in terms of cleanliness in many Government of India survey. Density of population is also low, hence the pollution and better lifestyle for the citizen. Most of the students are multilingual and well-versed in Hindi and English, and culture is mixed. So almost all the states, all the state people is from all the states are living in this Madhya Pradesh. In terms of job opportunity, because employment is very important aspect of the educational growth. So in terms of employment prospect in the state, many industrial area of the state near to Bhopal, near to Indore, just like Pithampur, Mau, Dhar, all are developing in full pace due to the state government policy to attract the new investment. Newly, Government of India initiative on Delhi, Mumbai industrial corridor, lot of cities are going to have a development opportunity on this industrial corridor. Many film shooting is happening last decade, many states seen many film shooting in the Madhya Pradesh near to Bhopal, Indore, Mandu, and many forest area. So now MP is attracting national attention on this front also. MP, due to geographical location of Madhya Pradesh, MP becomes now logistic hub in terms of warehousing and other allied activities. Many industry which is now fast growing in Madhya Pradesh is spinning, rice mills, agro industries, IT sector, automobile sector, major brands are coming up to many industrial areas. International hotel chains are also coming in Madhya Pradesh. In terms of challenges, transition phase, which our honorable chairman Bharat Singh Saranji was telling, that MP is the second state in the country which implemented NEP after Karnataka. So on that front, there is a like challenge in terms of providing more trained teacher faculties for schooling to college level. More exposure will be needed for the student to MP become a level of student from leading metro city of the country. My suggestion on this forum, when we compare India's most literate state, Kerala, with the literacy rate of 94%, the literacy of MP need to be improved. In terms of CGR, we are almost close to national level. In terms of GR ratio, we are almost close to national level GR ratio, average level. But we need to work on this front also. From government side, there is a need to promote this state in terms of geographical location and other benefit on the national level to develop this state as an education hub. Greater focus needed on improving literacy rate and promoting higher education and other factor. So this is from my side. I hope that we already have more senior educators like Kamlesh Mishra sir, Bharat Singh ji, and Dheeraj Kumar ji, which is like promoting MP in design sector. A lot of initiative he is doing on his forum. So I would like to listen from them also. Thank you once again, SOCHM, for organizing this seminar with IES University to give us opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Your 22 years of experience, we also heard about all the eminent national universities, the law and order benefits, the green, clean state, the low cost of living, the low population. And we really hope along with you that it will help us in taking our state to the next level. So thank you so much, sir. I'm happy to invite our next speaker, Professor Dheeraj Kumar, Director, National Institute of Design, Madhya Pradesh. Professor Dheeraj Kumar had joined the Institute as Director in January 2019. He's a passionate, meticulous, and enterprising design professional. Professor Dheeraj is a man of principles who firmly believes in discipline as a fundamental building block of educational environment. Professor Dheeraj feels that a creative and progressive approach is key to institution building. He is a discerning and conscientious team leader who believes in setting clear goals for his team and drives them to stick to core objectives with clear responsibility and authority in a system-driven manner with ample scope to accommodate human aspects. He seeks to apply his knowledge and extensive experience of design education for masses to seamlessly integrate traditional approach and latest innovation and technology for the betterment of society. Welcome, Professor Dheeraj Kumar. We would like to hear from you.
Sir, please unmute yourself.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, all right. So thank you, Professor Manisha, for a very elaborate introduction and heartfelt gratitude to the team behind SOCHM's National Council on Education and team IES University. I have been in part of a couple of other forums which were initiated by IES University, and all of them are very profound and very focused. And special thanks to B.S. Yadav ji, who happens to be a person who keep connecting me back to these wonderful forums. So today's topic is quite interesting because when I received it, I really felt this is something which when I came to Madhya Pradesh in year 2019. And within, I think, within a week, I started feeling that it's a very understated state. You know, people really have a very, the people have a very different perception about it, and the reality is very different. So when I came, and after that, when I started, because I'm founding the new institute, National Institute of Design, Madhya Pradesh, which is one of its four campuses where design education is being, first time expanded in the country. From the government point of view. So at that point of time, when I was setting it up and I was interacting with a lot of state university teams and the state education department, I really felt a lot of buoyancy and a lot of momentum was building in the education sector. And there were a lot of noticeable, you can say, events and things which were happening parallelly. So that was giving me a lot of confidence that I think NID is in a very right place at a very right time when the whole state is on a very buoyant mode now. Then in 2020, when NEP came into being, in existence. So it was a document which I think everyone appreciated, everyone instantly fell in love with. And secondly, by the time I think NEP was about to gain little momentum, COVID-19 kind of disrupted everything. And somewhere COVID-19 and NEP, both of them acted as a level playing field factors for the education sector. I could see that, suddenly because of these two things, at least in India, and because of COVID-19 at a global scale, what really happened was education providers, they all came on a similar platform. They were facing with similar challenges. They were trying to reposition. They were trying to deal with this unprecedented, pandemic. So not many institute, they immediately moved on to the hybrid or to the, online mode. And we started witnessing that, in spite of a lot of resistance from whether it is faculty or student, everyone migrated. And something which earlier was felt very unachievable, everybody, started becoming very comfortable. Today, whether it is a school going student or a university going student or a professor or a school teacher or a kindergarten teacher, everyone is adept with the, technology and the interface which comes with the technology. So that's where I see that. I think now what is very important is that the institutes which will focus on growing from here, because everyone almost is on the same level. So that is where the whole, I think, roadmap will be for almost every institution. And, borrowing two important sub themes from today's topic. One is, I think, looking at the NEP, and secondly, looking at NID Madhya Pradesh. Madhya Pradesh as the hub of the education. So in NEP, when I was, this is a document which probably, I have referred many a times, though design education is not coming under the ambit of NEP, but still I find the document to be very profound. I realized two things, that one, after a gap of almost 34 years, this was one major reform which happened in the education sector. Where a lot of consultation was done at even a grassroots level. This is the first time. Otherwise, normally most of the education reforms and policies are made in in a top level strata of that value chain. So that is, I think, very assuring for me that somewhere there were a lot of ground level considerations which were being made, and there was only one core message from the government. And in last 2 years after its launch, we have seen that as coming across in a very serious manner. This year, when first year NEP was being celebrated, so Prime Minister participated wholeheartedly and brought in a lot of renewed energy all over again. And the message was that how to revamp the Indian education scenario, because that is something which always has been close to the heart of all the educationists and education body, but because of the absence of an adequate policy framework, we all were finding it very difficult. Then looking at, I think, NEP, I'll not get into the detail because I think we all have been hearing about it in last almost 2 years. But I will just pick up two very important features from it, which are very close to my heart. For a certain reason, which kind of gives autonomy to all the institutions to become focused on innovation, which is becoming a global phenomenon. So one of it is, I think, academic bank of credits. So if we try to go deeper into that, academic bank of credit is basically talking about that what kind of qualitative development we can do at every institute level, and why a student should choose a particular institute to learn a particular credit or learn a particular learning from them. So that is, I think, one. And Benjamin Bloom's taxonomy is another thing which I really feel that it was overdue, and unfortunately very piecemeal intervention was there in our Indian education system. More so in private education system, it was evident, but in the public sector, the Bloom's taxonomy was fragmentally applied. So these two really brings in a new perspective towards the education approach, and a lot of other provisions, you know, making it a holistic education and you know, focus on skill development, focus on industry, you know, industry linked programs, and also all those things are the important thing. So as I began, when I said, like, when I came to Madhya Pradesh, I really felt that I think it's a very understated state. So first thing which I really realized, you know, that because I have a very young son, I was searching for a lot of schools. So and secondly, I was looking at whether to move to Bhopal or not, because I think by the time my tenure will be over, my son will be into his higher education. So what kind of options are there? So I was pretty surprised that Bhopal, as well as Madhya Pradesh altogether, hosts a lot of interesting INIs, a lot of other reputed educational institutions. So when I tried to compare, I think it was coming second to Delhi. At that point of time, I remember, if my memory is correct, so Delhi was having the maximum number of INIs, and then after that, it was Bhopal and Madhya Pradesh. So, but somewhere, you know, in last 2 years, we have been interacting with most of the institutes on a very personal level. We realized that I think what is missing is a common thread, you know, a common understanding. There is no platform where institutes can interact together. I really don't know how or whether we have a body where, you know, private institutions formally work together on certain common agendas or not. So I think when we look at a hub, the basic definition of hub is where there is a seamless, you know, connectivity of you know, you can say working, or whether it is a physical aspect of it, or it's a, you know, cognitive aspect of it. So I think those things work together. If you try to look at the educational hubs globally, they are more like education cities where the entire ecosystem is designed from the student point of view. There are a lot of, you know, job opportunities which are part-time in nature for the student, where they learn learn and start respecting the value of, you know, earning while learning and all. So that is, I think, one of the important thing which I really feel we should be focusing on. So one of the most important thing under the you know, umbrella of one of the you know, oldest HHM body in India, who's participating in this NAMIT task, is, I think, can be done is there can be a task force to have a MP as an hub, and this task force can look at, you know, creating a consortium or maybe couple of consortiums which can bring together most of the institutions together towards common agendas. And another thing, I think globally, one more thing is very evident, that they have quality assurance agency for the education sector also. In India, that sort of approach is missing. We have regulatory bodies, but their function and role is very different. So probably MP education department can start a wing with the help of some of the universities to have a quality assurance agency, where some sort of qualitative assessment on regular basis and feedback mechanism should be, you know, put in place. When I think I received this invitation, I was just trying to, you know, figure out one thing, that, you know, how do we figure as a nation on a global you know, platform. So UNESCO kind of published, there are two data which are available from UNESCO, one which is in 2019. So Indian students who went to study abroad, there were around 461,000 students, which is like 7.6% student, entire student base. They aspire to study abroad. And the countries which were the top destinations were US, Australia, Canada, Russia, Kazakhstan, Saudi Arabia, and Japan. And from 130,000 to 1,145 students, that is the kind of range we are talking about per country. And then I was just trying to compare it, that how many students actually visited to study in India, or India hosted them for their studies. So the number is around 49,348. So it's 0.8%. So I think this needs to be considered as one of the important data. And the data further, when you look into deep into it, there are 118 countries the students they come from study in India. And further, the data can be looked at a little more diagnostically. But the whole thing is this transnational education aspect has been quite dormant in our country. We really don't focus that. I think when this multiculturalism or globalized education scenario happens, the learning happens on a very different speed and scale. So most of the best institutions in the world, they have a very global culture. They have a multicultural, or a, they focus on transnational campuses and all that. So we should definitely focus on that. This task force can definitely look at how to tap, what kind of strategy can be there, where the institutions can be allowed to travel abroad to participate in institutional events and education events to promote and invite the student to come here. Then I think another thing which I feel I propose is that I think a whole lot of hub profiling, when we are looking at MP as a hub, so the profiling needs to be done. And the most important factor in that should be from the student's point of view. What do students want to learn? Why would they want to come to MP? The weather is fantastic, terrain is very good, culture is nice, you learn a lot from industry around here. But can it be cohesively packed for them? That is, I think, one. And then I think it should be linked with their jobs also, that when they come here, can we link it with the certain OJTs and certain other long-term job prospects also? So I think from the talent point of view, that is second. And third, one can look at it from the knowledge hub, where I think a lot of researchers can start coming here. And they should start working together with the institutions to do some original research work and all that, which is published and then which brings another level of credibility. Certain simple things like certain physical help desks or help desks, which are like e-kiosks, can be created for these hubs, where I think people can learn about the prospects of studying in Madhya Pradesh. Internationally, there is a culture of having a student card, which is other than their institutional card. They have a card of a educational city, which gives them a lot of other benefits in terms of part-time employment, in terms of certain benefits in certain purchases and all that. So one can, I think, learn from those kind of things also. And the most important thing, a networked and cohesive approach towards faculty and staff development, because I think that should be one of the most primary here. Because unless until the faculties are adaptive to this complete 360-degree shift of culture of education, anything which we try to do as a policy will not work. And then bringing together so many activities under these consortiums, whether it is conducting conferences, seminars, symposiums, or annual meets, or certain cultural programs, student activities, I think all that definitely can follow the moment a meta level structure is, or a framework is in place. And I think synergies between certain institutes, where they can start offering certain twinning programs, joint programs, whether it is a public funded or a private university, I think those venues should be explored. Recently, we have signed an MOU with AIIMS Bhopal, and we are working on some programs where design and medical sector will work together. So I think very soon we will have some sort of initiative in that. So
thank you, sir. Sorry to cut short. We'll be hearing more from you through the question answer session also. So thank you for appreciating the fast online mode transition and the digital fluency that the faculties here have got, and your suggestions to bring in positivity, to revamp the educational scenario and policies, and your recommendation on a common platform for interaction between institutes is noted. And of course, the opportunity to earn and learn for students, no doubt that will be very good. Also, the task force for common agendas and the culture to be created for global exchange students. So thank you so much, sir, for your views. And we shall get back to you during the question answer session. So our next speaker today is Dr. Bharat Charan Singh, Chairman, Madhya Pradesh Private University Regulatory Commission. Welcome, sir. He is representing the government on this platform. So Dr. Bharat Charan Singh, Chairman, Madhya Pradesh Private University Regulatory Commission, Bhopal, was having a vast experience in academics. He has served as Professor of Zoology at Pandit S.N. Shukla University, Shahdol. Dr. Singh published many research papers which recognized national and international level, and also attended various seminars. He has been awarded a gold medal by the Zoological Society of India for his contribution in the field of zoology. Some of his publications are Snatoktar Rasayan, Jantu Vigyan Ek Adhyayan, Swami Vivekanand Ek Prerak, Principles of Zoology, and so on. Some of his articles are published in leading magazines like Yuvao Mein Khoji Drishti, Unity in Diversity, Desh Prem Ki Bhavna, Bharat Mein Janjatiya Sanskriti, and Swami Vivekanand Ka Sanyasi Ehsaas. Sir, we admire you for following our eminent politician and revolutionary, our freedom fighter, Swami Vivekanand. So welcome, sir, and we would like to hear you.
Thank you, Manisha ji. Is webinar mein upasthit Kumar Shekhar Vijayan ji, Professor Dheeraj Kumar ji, हमारे मित्र बी एस यादव जी, कमलेश मिश्रा जी, मनीषा कावठेकर जी, नीरज अरोरा जी एवं दीपक छाबड़ा और नीरज छाबड़ा जी। मेरे पूर्व काफी वक्ताओं ने इस संबंध में अपने विचार रखे हैं। स्वाभाविक रूप से एनईपी से संबंधित काफी विषय आ चुके हैं। आज का इस विषय का टॉपिक है अपॉर्चुनिटीज एंड चैलेंजेज, और आयोजन में एसओचएम और आईएएस यूनिवर्सिटी की भूमिका है। मैं सभी का एक बार अभिवादन करते हुए, और विगत दो वर्षों से जिन विषयों के सर्वाधिक चर्चा थी हमारे भारतवर्ष में, उसमें तो एक कोरोना था और दूसरा राष्ट्रीय शिक्षा नीति। यह राष्ट्रीय शिक्षा नीति ने हमारी और आपकी विचारों के बाद जो विषय सामने आए हैं उनको शामिल करते हुए बनाई गई है। एक प्रकार से ऐसा कह सकते हैं 21वीं सदी के राष्ट्रीय परिवेश को ध्यान में रखकर, या देश को जिस प्रकार से नागरिकों की आवश्यकता है उस प्रकार से लोग तैयार हो, इसके पीछे यह भी एक चिंतन है। और जिस प्रकार से अलग अलग चैप्टर है, तो एक वर्ष तो हाथ से निकल गया, अब जो दूसरा वर्ष है और जिसको अपन को एक्सिक्यूट करना है, तो की एरिया ऑफ फोकस पर ध्यान देना है और मेकिंग इट हैपन्स पर ध्यान देना है। और ये एनईपी 2020, यदि इसकी हम थोड़ा सा इतिहास में जाए, यद्यपि दोनों का एक दूसरे से संबंध तो नहीं है, लेकिन एपीजे अब्दुल कलाम ने इंडिया 2020 ए विजन फॉर न्यू मिलेनियम 2010-11 में पब्लिश किया था कि 2020 का भारत निर्माण की दृष्टि से, विकसित होने की दृष्टि से किस प्रकार से होना चाहिए। और ये एक संयोग भी हो सकता है कि एनईपी 2020 जो उस समय उनकी कल्पना थी उसको साकार करने वाली है। राष्ट्रीय शिक्षा नीति की चर्चा तो टीचिंग स्टाफ इंक्लूडिंग हायर एजुकेशन एंड स्कूल एजुकेशन ये काफी हुआ है और लोग अवेयर भी हुए हैं, लेकिन स्टूडेंट और उनके पेरेंट्स गार्जियन के बीच में अभी भी बहुत कुछ किया जाना शेष है। अभी अपन स्वराज 75 अमृत महोत्सव को ध्यान में लेकर के उसको केंद्र में मान करके कई विधाओं में एक यह विधा भी किस प्रकार से कर सकते हैं कि स्टूडेंट भी अवेयर हो और गार्जियन भी अवेयर हो। पब्लिक फील्ड में जाने पर अंग्रेजी के महत्व को नकारा नहीं जा सकता। बहुत से इंटेलेक्चुअल्स हमारे साथी एक प्रश्न करते हैं, प्रश्न यह कहते हैं कि हमारा बालक आफ्टर प्राइमरी एजुकेशन यानी ABCD सीखना प्रारंभ करेगा, लेकिन ऐसा नहीं है। ये दोनों पॉलिसी में डिफरेंस है। अभी तक जो प्राइमरी एजुकेशन प्रचलन में है वह है स्टैंडर्ड फर्स्ट से स्टैंडर्ड फिफ्थ, यानी ये 12-13 वर्ष की आयु तक का है। और यही धारणा लोगों के मन में है कि हमारा बालक 12-13 वर्ष के बाद क्या ABCD सीखेगा? नहीं, इस प्राइमरी एजुकेशन में 5-3-3-4 जो बात आई है, इसमें 5 ईयर का जो प्राथमिक है वो प्री स्कूलिंग के 3 है, नर्सरी और स्कूलिंग के 2। इसका मतलब कि और जब हमारा बालक 6 और 7 वर्ष का होगा तो ठीक है, इस समय तो उसकी उम्र ही रहती है कि अपनी मदर लैंग्वेज जो भी होगी, रीजनल लैंग्वेज होगी, उसी में सीखना है। और हम लोग ये भी जानते हैं कि ब्रेन का डेवलपमेंट केवल 6 वर्षों तक ही होता है, न्यूरॉन्स जो बनते हैं केवल 6 वर्षों तक। 6 वर्ष के बाद जो भी डेवलपमेंट होता है वह सराउंडिंग और एनवायरमेंट से होता है। तो इस प्रकार से इसके पीछे साइंटिफिक एक्सप्लेनेशन भी है। और जहां तक चैलेंजेज या अपॉर्चुनिटी की बात है, तो जब चैलेंज चैलेंज के रूप में लिया जाता है तो स्वाभाविक है वो चैलेंज अपॉर्चुनिटी बन जाता है, और कोविड काल में हमने इसको सिद्ध कर दिया है। अब जहां तक चैलेंज की बात है तो वास्तव में अभी हमारा मध्य प्रदेश के संदर्भ में देखें, हम निश्चित रूप से मध्य प्रदेश को एजुकेशनल हब बनाएंगे और उस दिशा में हम तीव्र गति से आगे बढ़ भी रहे हैं। और जहां कहीं परामर्श और काउंसलिंग जरूरत पड़ेगी तो हमारे पास शोभित और ऋषि हुड यूनिवर्सिटी के लोग बैठे हुए हैं, आप लोग हैं, आप लोगों का बराबर सहयोग लिया जाएगा। अभी मध्य प्रदेश का जो स्थान है ग्लोबल अपने सिनेरियो में भारतवर्ष में वह है 22वां स्थान है। अपना प्रयास से होना चाहिए कि 22वां क्यों, इसको हम टॉप 10 में कैसे ला सकते हैं। और जिस प्रकार से हमारा प्राइवेट सेक्टर पब्लिक सेक्टर इस क्षेत्र में काम कर रहा है, स्वाभाविक है आने वाले समय में हम अपनी पोजीशन को थोड़ा सा कंफर्टेबल लाएंगे और 22 से ऊपर बढ़ेंगे। राष्ट्रीय शिक्षा नीति में आप देखे होंगे कि स्कूल एजुकेशन में 100% बाई
20 आप वीडियो ऑफ कर लीजिए सर, आपका इंटरनेट ठीक नहीं आ रहा है।
Yes, while sir is logging back, I will quickly summarize what he was speaking on, that the NEP will be fulfilling the vision of our late Honorable President Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam about how the NEP is working right from early education to higher education. And of course, we appreciate all the efforts of the government, which has gone into designing of this NEP so that after 3 decades we are able to implement something which will be so effective in revamping our education.
Nisha ji, meanwhile, can we request our next speaker, Professor Kamlesh?
Okay. Mishra ji? Yeah. Right. So while we wait for Bharat sir, we shall move on to our next speaker, and we will continue with him when he joins. So next speaker is Professor Kamlesh Mishra sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor Rishi Hood University. Professor Kamlesh Mishra is a PhD in economics from Northeastern University, Boston, USA. He did his advanced training in financial management from Harvard University for International Development, USA. He currently holds the position of Vice Chancellor of Rishi Hood University, Sonepat. He was the founding Vice Chancellor of Oro University, Surat, and also the Vice Chancellor of Ansal University, Gurgaon. Professor Kamlesh Mishra is a reputed strategist and innovative leader in conceiving, organizing, and managing education and research organizations. He combines in him qualities of vision building, organizing, motivating, and leading teams to perform at their peak level. He is well regarded as a thoughtful leader and a speaker on the formulation and implementation of corporate strategies, knowledge, and innovation management. Professor Mishra is known for creating some of the most successful business models in the educational sector without compromising on the ethical dimensions of teaching as a profession. He is a team builder and has created institutions which are talked about due to their work culture and the free environment for academic inputs. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Manisha ji. Thank you so much. I think, you know, based on the discussion so far, and let me pick up from where Guru Shekhar ji started. I think first, you know, we need to understand, is there a need to create a hub? Not only in Madhya Pradesh, in any place. In my view, a hub is created either through a deliberate policy of the government or a natural clustering of very, very high quality institutions. So a hub is not that we have 25 institutions of very low quality. We could have 10 good universities or institutions in a certain defined area, which are of very, very high quality, and it becomes a hub, because a hub is supposed to attract things. You know, so if you don't have very high quality institutions, students are still not going to come, you know, not only nationally, internationally, but not even nationally. So I think we need to think about this, that if there is a need to create a hub, then it has to be part of a government policy. Firstly, it's going to be very, very difficult to create educational hubs when the government policies are not there. If we want to create an export zone, you will see advertisements on the television, in the newspaper, full page ads with the photo of the chief minister and everyone. But have you ever seen any for creating an educational hub? Any state government that has promoted in a big way? There are a few examples, but not as a major effort that has been done. My thought is very simple, that if we focus on creating very high quality institutions, then we can create what is required to attract students from different parts. And larger the number of students who begin to look at that region as a great place to study, it slowly automatically begins to emerge as an education hub. Now, I'm not very sure whether we should think about creating a hub, a state as a hub, or we should identify cities first, which become the hubs. So if you have 5-6 major cities in Madhya Pradesh, which initially begin to develop these clusters, and then they all get connected to create the state as the education hub of the country. Now, when we look at the education policy, NEP 2020, I think one of the good things about the NEP 2020 is that it can be a major catalyst in creating that hub, if you want, because the hub is going to be created only by enhancing the quality of education. So here is an opportunity for us to implement the new education policy in a way that it runs across all universities and institutions in the state and is implemented well. And we should do what we really say that we are going to do. And I'm very, very sure that a lot of, even in the state of Haryana, for example, the Haryana Higher Education Commission is doing a lot of work. Their target was 2025. They have pulled the target to 2023 for implementation. But the number of meetings that we have with them, the number of visits they're making to the universities, and actually asking universities to tell how are we implementing, rather than they're not saying how you should implement. They say that, okay, here's the education policy, 450 pages, you have read it. Now you tell how, what is your plan? You know, and so they're not developing a single plan for everyone, as Kumarji said, that every university has to work in an autonomous fashion to implement the key aspects of the policy. And so all of us are working that. For us at Rishi Hood, it's a little easier for us because we are a new university, so we don't have a backlog that we need to do anything about that or to bring about a change. All our structures are now based on the new education policy itself, whether it is interdisciplinary or whatever it is. But there are also advantages to universities that are already existing to enhance their quality, because if you have 25 different disciplines and you want to make first year as a common curriculum, which we are doing, for example, in our university, the first year, 80% of the courses are common across all disciplines, whether it is design, whether it is education, whether it is management, everyone has to go through 80% of the courses, which are identical for everyone. Only 20% of the courses are subject specific or discipline specific. Thus, it also allows our students to change their mind to move from one degree program to another degree program after the first year. That's one thing that we have done. So cross-disciplinary programs, if you are an existing university, you already have 15, 20 different schools operating. Students are taking courses across different schools to make sure that we have a focus on general education. So I think, you know, the new education policy provides a very, very good platform for us to start to enhance the quality of education. I would suggest that what we are doing in Haryana is that we are working very, very closely with the State Higher Education Commission, very, very closely, you know. And we are trying to come up with the good parts of what every university is planning to do. So we are also learning from each other that what is going to succeed and what is not going to succeed. Nobody is in the dark as far as the implementation of the education policy is concerned. So I think if we have to make Madhya Pradesh the hub, let's pick up Bhopal, you know, and let's create Bhopal as the education hub, which means that all universities in and around Bhopal first have to come together as a policy. But it also has to be backed by the government. Unless the government backs this to develop Bhopal as the education hub, it's going to be very difficult. Because see, whatever we say, let's be very, very clear that even in the minds of the policymakers, there is a difference between a private university and a public university, whether they say it or they don't say it, right? They don't say it because it's not good to say, but they believe in it because nobody knows that they believe in it. But there is a difference. If I become, as a private university, if I become member of Association of Indian Universities, I pay more fees. If it's a private public university, they pay less. If there is an inspection in a private university, then you pay more. If it's in public university, you pay less. So there are differences. And, you know, education hubs are created when there is a level playing field. You know, it's like United States. Look at a place like Boston. You know, Boston is a hub of education. But I can tell you that I, as a student, can apply for government funding for my education. If I'm given that funding, I can go to a private university or a public university. It doesn't matter. I just need to specify where I'm going, and that money is going to get transferred to that university. It doesn't matter whether it's private or public. These are things that create a conducive environment for creating hubs. I personally don't feel that India is still ready at this point, but that does not mean that we should not make the efforts towards that direction. What we are seeing today in the new education policy, last 20 years, people have been pushing for these things, and finally it has happened. So a lot of people's efforts have worked here. So it will be good for us all to work towards these kind of objectives, because then slowly that environment is created that the government also comes out and says, okay, let's do something like this. I think that's what I would say. Let's focus on implementation. Let's focus on the quality of education. And once you have quality, the word spreads, people start coming, students will come from everywhere. And then it is our capacity to attract students, faculty from different parts of the world that creates the hub. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Really appreciate your practical approach and your vision for educational hubs for the common curriculum in first year, the coordination between the government and private universities. Thank you, sir, for your inputs. Shall we begin with the question answer session, Neeraj sir?
Yes, please. Yes.
First, I would like to welcome Dr. Bharat Charan Singh. Because of some technical issues, he had dropped out. So, sir, we were waiting to hear from you. So we would like to know a little about the government initiatives for higher educational institutes.
Excuse me, ma'am. I think Bharat
Charan Singh, sir.
I don't think he's not there.
He's still not there. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Then I will put the next question to Shri Kumar Shekhar Vijendra, sir. So which skills in particular you feel may be promoted in MP for success of NEP? In your opinion, which are the skills which can be promoted?
Actually, when we look at NEP, Manisha, it talks about human skills also. Mm-hmm. And for the success of any policy, be it NEP or any other policy, we all have to have a school of gumption. Life skills, and which is very important. And I'm really happy to note this thing, that all private universities, especially private universities, they are very serious about it, to develop the life skills of their students. And if we really want that this NEP should be implemented, what it means to me actually, that what our education system was doing, we were concentrating more on our head. All information or everything should be put there. So NEP has given an opportunity to think about heart of the students and to give them a hand also to apply the knowledge.
Absolutely.
So that part has to be there. And I think this skill is the most important skill, what needs to be implemented everywhere, including Madhya Pradesh.
Right. So we talk of better life skills, of better, more ethical human beings, because the technical knowledge will of course be there, the skills will be there, but in order to be of use to society, the life skills are the most important. Thank you so much, sir. For Engineer B.S. Yadav, sir, Honorable Chancellor, IS University, I have a question here, that which careers and professions you feel will come up after the implementation of NEP, because students are extremely keen to know that which are the courses they should pursue so that they make a profitable career and they have a successful professional life.
Thank you, Manisha. So in my opinion, as the traditional courses like engineering, technology, polytechnic, all these courses will be in forefront. But definitely after implementation of NEP and this local development of local industry, I think textile and designing will be the thrust area where a new employment opportunity will be there. As Dheera sir is already there, so lot of, like, apart from government institution, lot of private institutions are also coming. Apart from this, I think agro industry is also having big potential in the state of Madhya Pradesh for employment. Because looking the growth in terms of yearly growth compared to other state of the country in food, grains, rice and other areas. So I think this is also industry which will be a focus area for the employment point of view also.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you, sir. So your answer has automatically led us to Professor Dheeraj Kumar. So, sir, what are your suggestions on incorporating creativity into higher education in order to foster innovation? Like you were talking of having more innovation. So we would like your input on that, sir.
The innovation, I think, is something which cuts across almost all the disciplines. It is nothing to do with design. It is about your approach, how you look at it. So I think all the disciplines should have a factor of innovation in them. And to start with, I think they can be a small cell in almost all the universities to, you know, propagate. There is a regular monitoring, because innovation requires some sort of regular persistence in the system, and somebody monitors it and reflects back on it. So there should be annual audit on that. So that is what I suggest.
Right, sir. Very true. No doubt innovation is required in all disciplines. And as Yadav sir has also said, that design and textile and creativity, this will definitely get a better edge in MP, given that we are known for our bag and dabu and already over the ages. So the next question is for Professor Kamlesh Misra, sir. Sir, you had talked about funding. So what are your recommendations for increasing the funding to motivate students to go into higher education, to create a win-win situation so students get funding and universities get students and the society gets empowered professionals?
My ideas are very radical, and most people don't appreciate radical ideas. I am of the belief that public university funding should be changed. Public universities should be funded in two blocks. The first block is which is given to them on an annual basis, but the second block is given to the student. It is the amount of money that they will get. It depends on the number of students they take from that category of funded students. But that category should be open to all universities. It should not be open only to public universities. So the only difference that public universities have is that they may get 50 crores every year. Other than that, now they have to either raise the funds, or they need to get students who get government scholarships. But government scholarships are open to students, and students have the right to go to any university they want, whether it's a public university or a private university. In that way, public universities also will come under the ambit of intense competition to take students who need, and private universities also will be able to compete along with public universities. So that's my opinion as far as funding of universities is concerned. And research funding should be open to all universities, whether they're public or private universities. As long as they are doing a good job, that's what is required. The differences that we have, which are built-in biases of the policymakers, because they have not been able to get out of the socialistic mindset yet. They are under the cover of a market economy, but still very socialistic in their thinking.
Right, sir. Thank you. That will be very empowering for the students if they can get the funds and they can decide which university to go to, rather than giving to peer pressure. They can make proper informed decisions.
Absolutely.
So indeed. So With your permission, Neeraj sir, shall we end the session because I cannot see Bharat sir still.
Yes, sure, sure.
Manisha, Bharat Singh ji message me, he is not able to reconnect because due to this electricity and net issue.
Oh, right. So,
yeah, so
it was a very, very empowering session. So I would like to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of ASSOCHAM and IES University. So today's session was most interesting and enlightening, and I deem it my privilege to propose the vote of thanks to all our esteemed speakers. I wish to express my earnest gratitude to Sri Kovar Shikhar Vijayendraji, co-chairman ASSOCHAM National Council on Education and co-founder and chancellor Shobhit University, for sharing his vision on NEP and for giving us valuable guidance. We are indebted to you, sir, for presenting your views. We are especially thankful to have gained insight from Engineer B.S. Yadav, Vice Chair MP Chhattisgarh ASSOCHAM Educational Council and Honorable Chancellor IS University. Sir, your experience, guidance and perspective regarding NEP will help us in implementation of the policy. My heartfelt thanks to Dr. Bharat Charan Singh, sir, Chairman, Madhya Pradesh Private University Regulatory Commission, Bhopal MP, for briefing us about the critical points in NEP and for clarifying a few key aspects. We appreciate your input and we are sorry that he could not continue, but definitely we shall expand our thinking and this will help us lead from learning to development with the efforts of the government on our side. I extend my most sincere appreciation to Professor Dheeraj Kumar, sir, Director, National Institute of Design, MP, for educational expertise, which has given us conceptual understanding of the salient features and your tips for adopting a more creative outlook and more coordination between different universities. I also wish to acknowledge the perspective of Professor Kamlesh Mishra, sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Rishud University, for your views and suggestions, which were very impactful and indeed radical. Special thanks to Mr. Neeraj Arora, Senior Director and Head ASSOCHAM National Council on Education, for his encouragement, support, and for arranging this session for us. Along with the entire team of ASSOCHAM, especially Sri Deepak Chabra and Sri Harish Pushpakar, who have been with us from conception to execution. My deepest regards to all the industry experts and educators present here today, the management, principals, headmasters, coordinators, faculties of all institutions who take pride in their work. Your participation in today's webinar made it a resounding success. Education is a commitment to learning and excellence, and together I'm certain we shall build the future of our students at MP. So thank you everyone for joining us today for this wonderful session.
And thank you, Professor Manisha, for the wonderful and timely moderation.
Thank you
so much. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Kumar Shekhar ji.
Ji, Neeraj ji, thank you. Dheeraj sir, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Neeraj ji.
Shekhar sir, thank you so much.
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद आप सभी का और बहुत थैंक यू वेरी मच. नमस्कार.
एंजॉय द एंटायर सेशन. थैंक यू सो मच.
थैंक यू. थैंक यू.